Well, hello there, YouTube. Make sure you subscribe. Make sure you click the bell. It is officially Antonio Gibson Day. You want to hear how we're breaking down the Washington backfield? Do you want to hear my joy pouring into this microphone? Then do not miss a moment.
Foot Clan, we're all kind of looking for a bright spot right now, are we not?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I got one for you. There's a hilarious new series on Apple TV Plus starring Jason Sudeikis called Ted Lasso. It's about an American football coach who heads to England to take a shot at managing one of the world's most competitive professional soccer teams. It's an age-old story.
Of course.
If you like a show with big laughs and a lot of heart, then this is the one you've been looking for. Watch Ted Lasso right now on the Apple TV app. Subscription required for Apple TV+.
Hey, this is Mike Kosicki, tight end for the Miami Dolphins, and you are listening to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Antonio Gibson, baby! Yes! Yes! The time is here!
Producer staring at levels. I can see the eyes of Al Borland.
Yeah! Let's go! Let's go! I apologize to everyone.
Yeah, that was not fair.
To my microphone.
You knew it was coming out there.
Look. Okay, I got to start here.
Oh, my goodness. Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers, Andy, Mike, and Jason. Friday, September 4th, also known as Antonio Gibson Day.
All right, now that the show has begun, we got to get this out of the way. Look. Adrian Peterson is one of my favorite players of all time. His picture is up in front of my desk. I think they did him a little bit dirty. I hope he ends on a contender.
Okay.
Having said that, now we get to the part where we celebrate Antonio Gibson is...
Mike has had a morning.
Look, on the drive-in, this was full, and producer Borland will appreciate this. This was full. Yellow card, Ocean Avenue. The volume was at maximum. I need a new steering wheel because... the drumming going on in the car on the drive. I've dismantled my entire car. Oh, man.
I'm picturing the cartoon car. Oh. You know the cartoon car where, like, the top of the car goes way up. It goes up and down and up and down, and the wheels stay on the ground. And it's
yes.
Like,
yeah, with hydraulics. Yeah, yeah, except that was just me bouncing my car.
If you are new to the show, welcome in. If you haven't gathered yet. Mike, the Fantasy Hitman, right, has been a long time, if there is such a thing at this point already, truther of Antonio Gibson, pre-draft, post-draft, hyped him up after the third-round pick, and after, you know, the presumed starter, Darius Geis, was released, it looked like the path was there.
It was emerging.
And the emergence has completed as far as you can complete before NFL games start.
And not even just the emergence. If you follow what the beat reporters like, they talked to Peterson, and on the way out, Peterson himself was saying, you know, I was noticing how they were using Gibson, how they're using McKissick. They want to have a main guy, and then the player he kept mentioning was Antonio Gibson. Like, it's
yeah, because your first reaction, Mike, when you found this out was. Yeah. Well, they maybe didn't want to guarantee Adrian Peterson the money because to this point, Adrian Peterson had been taking every first-team rep for the majority of this offseason, been a leader in the clubhouse. And so Mike's reaction was, well, maybe they bring him back after so they don't have to guarantee him that veteran money.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, you should read the comments that Adrian Peterson made, which was that, hey, they brought in Antonio Gibson
to be
this guy, which is a type of offense, which is the type of offense where the running back needs to be able to catch Christian McCaffrey level of passes if it's possible.
Mm-hmm.
So very, you know, if you were one of the many, many, many people that have drafted already and you buy into this hitman fella, then you
probably have Antonio
Gibson on your team. So we'll talk a little bit more about this. I have a specific question for us. As it pertains to this situation and how we see it playing out. It is Friday, though.
Foot Clan Friday.
All right, every Friday we give away a piece of sweet sports memorabilia from pristineauction.com. Today we're giving away a signed Josh Jacobs jersey.
Very nice.
Dame Dash over on Patreon, member of the Foot Clan, wins the Josh Jacobs jersey. Congratulations on that victory to my guy.
I am currently on Pristine Auction searching for Antonio Gibson.
Yeah.
Oh, there's nothing there yet. Pristine.
Get it together.
What is going on here?
You can use the code BALLERS over at Pristine Auction when you're browsing for Antonio Gibson merch, and you get $10 off. Also, I had teased on Twitter that we were having a Patrick Mahomes interview today, and we thought we were. That has been kicked down the road a little bit. So we do expect to still be able to air that interview for you, but not today.
Mm-hmm.
And what else is going on? Mike has an article up on the website, his Ultimate Value Hit Squad article. It comes out each and every year where he is finding the best values in each and every round of your draft. So if you have drafts still on the table, all of our major drafts in here are still to come. And you can check out that article at thefantasyfootballers.com. Quick question tying into the Antonio Gibson situation. It's basically this. How many carries do you believe Antonio Gibson will receive this year in Washington? Peyton Barber, according to camp reports, has had a strong camp. Another reason you could let go of Adrian Peterson. JD McKissick is there. Bryce Love makes the team.
Yep.
Will have some opportunities in this offense. But as we said, also, you know, Adrian Peterson on the way out the door understands that Antonio Gibson will basically have the best summary. He'll have as many opportunities as he can possibly earn.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. Is they wanted Antonio Gibson to be the starter, and they're going to find out. Like, I mean, I'm taking the world's largest preseason victory lap right now, and I know that, but look, this is just way too much fun. But Antonio Gibson still has to succeed on the field, but they're going to give him the chance now.
Jason and I were speaking before the show, Mike, while you were strutting in really slowly from the car for like an hour. Look, just when you parade, and
you'd be surprised how slow you move when you're levitating.
Yes. Yeah. It's not as fast as you think.
No, it's not.
I was wondering, do we have the CGI capability to just make Mike glow? He's already wearing the white shirt.
I was going
to
ask Al Borland if he could get a harness and lower me down.
Oh my goodness.
And I could just fly around the set.
But we've gone through the Ultimate Draft Kit is up to date. We move quickly on the changes in the Ultimate Draft Kit because we know people are drafting and need to be ready. I have Antonio Gibson down for 107 carries this year.
Oh.
Jason has him up at 199.
I have him at 185.
Okay. That was going to be figure out which side you were on. How do you think it breaks down with the four running backs remaining in Washington, then?
So I
like, would you take a shot at Bryce Love in your drafts?
I would, yeah. So now let's say your drafts have already happened. You missed out on the chance to grab Antonio Gibson with one of those late picks. I would probably look at who I drafted with my last skill position player and put Bryce Love on my bench. I mean, I haven't been on team Bryce Love, but now you have to play the game of probability. You have to look at what could possibly happen, and what could happen is Bryce Love could be very involved in this offense. So, yes, 100% I am with that. I have him projected for just 75 attempts, but in fantasy football, keep your eyes open of what could actually happen. I have, you know, I have it down for a decent timeshare where I got Gibson at 185. I have Peyton Barber at 120 carries. The difference maker for Gibson, it's the receiving work. We already knew that that was going to be the difference maker, because his ability to hit the home run, especially in the passing game, is tremendous. He currently sits as my running back 22, and people are asking, well, okay, where do you draft him now? I'm drafting him in that range. If you were going to take a running back where you take David Johnson, Todd Gurley,
Melvin Gordon,
those players there, no freaking way am I drafting those guys over Antonio Gibson. I'm going to take the upside chance that Antonio Gibson gets the workload that they whispered about right after the draft.
If Antonio Gibson works out, right, for your fantasy team and for the NFL. This will be it, when we go to the future and a team drafts a player specifically on physical traits, not on collegiate production, and you know how that happens, and we sometimes criticize the whether it's, I don't know, is it Denzel Mims' size or something, or, right, you know, a certain player comes out, and it's like, man, that's the next Dez Bryant physically. This will be why, because he will be a player with 33 carries in that teams could see through that situation.
You know what?
The upside.
It reminds me of a player who was drafted last year who had very little college production, but was by comparison to the top picks, but had a good draft capital, and his athletic profile was fantastic. It's his teammate Terry McLaurin, who was awesome last year and is now, you know, a big breakout candidate this season. The reality is the weight adjusted speed score of Antonio Gibson, which is otherworldly. You're talking 99th percentile. It's up there with Jonathan Taylor. It's up there with Saquon. When you get the opportunity to be on the field and utilize those things the way that, you know, it took a long time for David Johnson, his comp, to actually get the opportunity to thrive in that offense. As soon as he was given the ball, he succeeded with it. It took a while. This is a team that's saying, And all the camp reports have been glowing. I know Adrian Peterson was getting the first team reps, but so was Gibson all camp long. It was Adrian Peterson and Antonio Gibson getting first team reps, and now with him out of the way, I really believe that this is a system and an offensive coordinator that wants to use a primary three down back.
That was the quote from Peterson, is they want a main guy.
They want a three down capability on the field. They drafted him to have him there. He has the physical talents that have been showing out in camp, and I think he's going to touch the ball enough to be very, very fantasy relevant. He reminds me
quote from Adrian Peterson, the system really fits him. I feel like I can do that pony style too, more as a receiving back. We were all working on it, but they really want one main guy to do it, and they drafted Gibson to do it.
Boom.
He had the conversation. This is that, you know, we're entering the fantasy court today. This is eyewitness testimony to Ron Rivera and the offense, because when they had the conversation with Adrian Peterson, who they respect, they put the tweet out this morning, you know, a leader in the locker room all through camp, set the tone. You know, some beat writers talking about, look, Adrian Peterson was there to set the tone at camp. And then, Mike, you said they did him dirty because it's 6 days to the season. But that leadership, they had that throughout camp. Adrian Peterson is the one that talked to them. The discussion was, they explained to him what was the point.
Yeah, and I actually don't know that they did him dirty. Thinking back to the Leonard Fournette and this situation, roster cuts are this upcoming weekend. And so now they're letting him get out ahead of those roster cuts.
Yeah, a little bit. Okay.
And so, you know, it worked out for Fournette, but the
multiple teams are inquiring about Adrian Peterson already.
Yeah, the Jets will find a
for
team.
Sure.
I think the Bears. The Bears.
Yeah,
the Bears makes
that one makes
so much
a lot
sense.
Of sense. I just don't know if they can keep, you know, Gase away. but the three comp, the comps that I look at, you know, over the last couple of years, third round running backs with a pass catching skill set who had their starters ahead of them go down or get cut or traded. I'm talking about, there's two of them.
I know
there's
one of them.
Kareem Hunt and Alvin Kamara, one of which actually was Adrian Peterson ahead of him. Those guys were unbelievable their rookie year. The big difference, and obviously don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that he's going to be up to that level, because you talk about the Saints with Drew Brees,
right,
and the Chiefs with Pat Mahomes. The situation is very similar for the running back, the talent, the opportunity, but this is still the Washington football team with Dwayne Haskins. That's why I think the group that you were talking about, David Johnson, Melvin Gordon, Todd Gurley, that's where Antonio Gibson belongs, and it's a matter of, do you want the more
explosive,
trusted,
yeah,
you know, the more trusted, we've seen it before, but there's question marks players, or the new young gun explosive high upside, haven't seen it before.
Yeah, and I want to know what happens inside the five. Is Antonio Gibson the guy inside the five for, sure, Ron Rivera or not? That will answer a lot of questions in terms of upside. 1,100 total yards over under Antonio Gibson in 2020.
Over. I have him under. Oh, total? All purpose?
Yeah.
Oh, I have him over that.
Over.
For sure.
Okay. The Bucks waived Dare Ogunbowale. It was inevitable. They had, you know, Keyshawn Vaughn they drafted, picked up Fournette and McCoy, already had Ronald Jones. So somebody had to go. Goodbye, Dare.
Yeah.
Deebo Samuel, the 49ers are hopeful he will resume practicing next week. They did activate Richie James, wide receiver. They've been going through a lot of wide receivers in San Francisco. Is this a thing where if Debo's active for week one against Arizona, you would play him?
I would say no. I'm not going to play him if he's active week one. But this just highlights how incredible a draft day value that Deebo Samuel has been over the last week or so. That we talked about, the news has been trending very positive. It has gone from, well, we don't know what he's going to miss. He'll probably miss a few games, to maybe he's ready week one. And Deebo Samuel, had he never gotten hurt, Deebo Samuel's what, a fifth round, fourth round wide receiver pick, and you've been able to grab him in the eighth, ninth round.
Deebo Samuel would have been a my guy had it not been for the injury.
Sure.
He was that important to the offense with Emmanuel Sanders leaving. And how, I mean, this was a player that was a top five wide receiver in fantasy over the last half of the year. Deebo Samuel last year.
Right.
With Emmanuel Sanders.
The one thing of cold water I will pour on that is that this specific injury, usually it's not just a matter of when they can get back on the field. It's when they can get back to previous production levels, and that's not usually when they're back on the field. So if he starts slow, that's personally my expectation, is that if he's out week one or if he's out there week two, I'm not going to start him right away for probably a couple of weeks until he proves that, okay, his production is back to the level.
But are you drafting him in the eighth round?
You know, I will, because I can stash him and not play him. I will definitely draft him in best ball leagues where I know I'm getting the second half of the season. I'm in the playoff weeks because everyone is, and I don't have to know when to start him.
Two quick pieces of news before we get into the fantasy court. Trey Burton's going to miss at least the first 2 weeks of the regular season, Colts tight end. And then Mike Williams, who had the shoulder injury, if you've been watching Hard Knocks, was featured this past week, I believe, partially torn labrum. I'm not positive on that. Just a shoulder injury. Wasn't expected to be ready. They're now believing he might be ready for week one. Does that make him a late-round selection for you because he's potentially active? Probably not.
Yeah, probably not. I mean, he was already like a fringe late round. Do you want to take the chance of getting Tyrod Taylor's deep threat? Which, nope, he's had some success with that before, but he was already kind of borderline. So no, I would take the chance on other guys that are going to be around for week one. So, Footclan, we are going to get into the fantasy court.
Judge Giamatti, are you prepared for this?
Are
it's
you
been
robed?
A little while? Are you robed?
I'm always ready.
Keep the robe on.
I don't know if the FootClan knows this. He actually does wear a robe around the studio almost 100% of the time.
Yeah.
I don't know. I assume he's fully clothed under it, but he's always robed.
Never make assumptions.
That's true. FootClan, we want to thank today's sponsor, Simply Safe. If you're looking for a home security company, don't get trapped by all the stupid ones. The ones that make long contracts and commitments and hidden fees and all the old school, old busted security systems that cost you way too much and aren't even as up to date as Simply Safe. Simply Safe has everything you need to protect your home. None of those other drawbacks. They can keep monitoring. They watch day. They watch night. They send police. They send fire, whatever you need. And you can set it up yourself. No technician has to come to your house and do all it. These are really, really easy. It's peel and stick sensors. You put them exactly where you need. We have them at the studio. We use them in our personal lives. There's no contract, no pushy sales guy, no hidden fees. It all starts at $15 a month. Try Simply Safe today at simplysafe.com/footballers, and you get free shipping and a 60-day risk-free trial. There's nothing to lose. That's simplysafe.com/footballers.
And FootClan, we are having a good time on the show. We are celebrating Antonio Gibson. And look, it's Friday. Some people, you know, you're going to celebrate.
Labor Day weekend.
You're going to have a good time, and that's why we have a message from NHTSA. Make sure you are staying safe this holiday weekend, please. Almost 29 people in the United States die every day in an alcohol-impaired vehicle crash. That's one person every 50 minutes. This does not have to happen at all. And drunk driving can have a big impact on your wallet, too. Could get arrested, huge legal fees. You could lose your job. Ladies and gentlemen, plan accordingly. Have fun this weekend, yes, but make sure you are staying safe. How can you prevent drunk driving? Plan a safe ride home before you start drinking. Designate a sober driver. Call a taxi. If someone you know has been drinking, take the keys. Arrange for them to get a sober ride home. We all know the consequences of driving drunk, but one thing's for sure, you're wrong if you think it's no big deal. Drive sober or get pulled over.
All right. We're opening the doors. We're entering the courtroom. Judge Giamatti is prepared. He is fair and balanced from what I understand.
Judge Giamatti, did I tell you how handsome you're looking today?
Okay.
Have I done that yet?
All right.
No, you haven't.
Well.
You're looking great, Brooks.
Dang it.
Looking mighty fine. All right, let's do it.
The Fantasy Court with Judge Giamatti.
Plaintiffs Jason and Mike are accusing Andy Holloway of investment fraud and propping up the value of Derek Carr as a high-yield investment instead of an illegal Ponzi scheme. I am the plaintiff in this case, and I say to you...
And the announcer.
Sir, yes. Change. Turn the hat backwards. I say to you, Andrew Holloway...
Yeah. Yeah. Where do I have him?
Derek Carr as the quarterback 14.
Oof, that's on the cusp of being a QB1.
Well, that's on the cusp of being his best fantasy season ever. Now, I don't know if we are aware, but this is not Derek Carr's first or second or third or fourth or fifth or sixth season yet. We've seen him for a long time. This is not his best receiving core. He has had Michael Crabtree and Amari Cooper. He has had them both be wide receiver twos. He's had one year where he almost had a wide receiver one and a wide receiver one. It was one and two with Cooper and Crabtree. Never has he finished as a quarterback one. Now, I love the future. I love the excitement of the new hotness and the weapons. You got Henry Ruggs. You got
B. Rye.
Edwards, Darren Waller. Look, they're fun. But this is an offense that wants to run the ball. Remind me, Andy, Josh Jacobs, is he a my guy?
I plead the fifth.
Oh, okay. Part of the reason he's a my guy is because that's the centerpiece of this offense. It's not Derek Carr. And the last thing I will bring as Exhibit D here is Marcus Mariota.
Take it easy.
As Marcus Mariota's backup contract. They went and spent a lot of money to bring in Marcus Mariota. You don't do that unless you say there's a chance. You're not bringing him in case Derek Carr gets injured. You're bringing him in case Derek Carr stinks. And if he does, things get off to a bad start, they could make a pivot because the crowd and fans always want the backup. My point is, the trust is not in this offense in Derek Carr. He's never done it before. He doesn't have his best weapons. And to have him as quarterback 14.
Oh,
sir, Your Honor, I would like to submit the piece of evidence that Jason almost vomited as he was
looking at that ranking.
It was talking about Derek Carr.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
Are you done? Have you completed your arguments?
I rest my case.
Your Honor. I'm going to make sure I don't vomit during my reply. First of all, let me just say I've never been accused of such egregious crimes when I rank a player outside the top 12 before at a mere 14. But let me start by filing a countersuit against these two disrespectful hooligans, as they both have Derek Carr ranked 23rd out of, I think, spite. Your Honor, Derek Carr, in six NFL seasons, has never finished 23rd. He's never actually finished outside the top 20. They misrepresent. They misrepresent my client.
That's a fair point.
And I find it outrageous. Let me just make my case. He increased his completion percentage each of the last 3 years. He's been a 4,000-yard passer each of the last 2 years. He's had 10 or fewer interceptions each of the last 2 years. He has, dare I say, been a good quarterback in the National Football League. With Jack Squad available to him at the wide receiver position last year, he had a passer rating of over 100. Ninth in the NFL, better than Dak, Deshaun, Wentz, Rodgers, Ryan, Brady. He does not deserve to be spat upon, Your Honor. He never misses games, completed 70% of his passes. They just added Mike's favorite fellow, Brian Edwards. They have Henry Ruggs, Renfro, the Walrus, and weapons out of the backfield. And I contend, nay, I insist, that you hold my cohorts in contempt of court for this egregious disrespect and force them to move Derek Carr into at least their top 20 because that's all he's ever done.
Then I will bring the closing statement that
I'm the defense. Don't I get to close?
I thought you were done.
Not today. Mike, please close.
Your Honor.
Disregard this next testimony.
Derek Carr, over the last three seasons, my alleged friend over here has said, he doesn't miss games. He's playing all the time. Derek Carr has averaged under 21 passing touchdowns per season.
Yeah, he is actually an example, Your Honor, of the disproportionate, hard to predict touchdown percentage number where he went from, I believe, 3.7 to 4.1, still a little bit under. He had no weapons, and yet he has managed
to
win.
The rookie wide receivers.
No, this is not how a courtroom works. I get the last word. Your Honor, disregard all of those statements. What's your ruling?
The fantasy court rules in favor of the plaintiff.
Yeah, baby!
However, on the countersuit, I have a ruling as well.
Oh, I apologize.
I also rule in favor of the plaintiff of the countersuit.
Oh, no!
So that's me.
We're all guilty.
We're all guilty. Yep.
We all have to move Derek Carr to 20 on the dot. That's what that lawsuit means.
All right.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. We're going to our next case?
Yes. Plaintiffs Andy and Jason are accusing Mike the Fantasy Hitman Wright of ranking misrepresentation, pandering counterfeit goods as a genuine item.
All right. All right. I am the plaintiff in this situation. Mike is the defendant.
Yes.
Jason and I both have Mike Evans ranked well below where the defendant has him. Mike Wright has Mike Evans at 8. We have him at 15 and 20. Your Honor, wise, noble Judge Diamati, I might add. I am accusing my friend Mike, the Fantasy Hitman Wright. My friend that I am accusing of gross rankings manipulation, misrepresentation. Look, he's pandering some counterfeit goods here with the number 8 ranking of Mike Evans. Now, I'm going to get ahead of this. He's going to spend his time defending Mike Evans, likely giving you tales of all that Mike Evans has accomplished in his young career, how young he was when he accomplished it, and how he stands in the pantheon of all-time receiving greats. And, Your Honor, I ask you to pay no mind to this at this attempt at misdirection.
What is happening?
At misdirection. Fantasy football players, they get no bonuses this season for their career benchmarks, but instead only their performance each and every week. So may I enter into evidence today. Last season, Mike Evans ended the year as the wide receiver 12. Amazing considering he missed 3 games. Bravo.
Truly, truly
Bravo,
amazing.
Bravo, good sir. Or maybe not. He was the number 2 wide receiver in fantasy points per game from week 8 on. That is impressive.
Very.
Except it's not. He was the number 2 in points per game, but let me read you his fantasy finishes to end the year over the back 5 of his 7 weeks. 27th, 31st, 41st, 52nd, 27th. Still finished at number 2 in that span because he had a monstrous 2 weeks, weeks 8 and 9. And that changed that fantasy points per game for the entire back half of the year to where Mike Evans appears as a mirage as the number 2 receiver over that span.
We call this the Cooper argument against Mike.
I point you to the Cooper argument. Don't fantasy owners deserve some level of consistency from a top 8 wide receiver, some level of normalcy for their own sanity's sake, Judge? 5 out of 16 weeks, you were happy with Mike Evans. That is not the life I want, Your Honor. No more counterfeit goods. I rest my case.
Well, let me start out by saying, by calling for the 16 weeks, that is simply unfair because when he was not on the field, we were not starting Mike Evans in our
No, we weren't.
On our fantasy team. Your Honor, I'm going to start my case with the Holloway defense, as which was just used in our previous court case here. My colleagues have ranked Mike Evans 15 and 20. In his six years playing in the NFL, he has finished outside of the top 20 one time. One time.
Oh, he has finished there.
Oh, I didn't realize he had.
I didn't either. I thought he was going to say it's never happened.
That's helpful.
So this, okay, go continue. No, thank you for the information.
His second year in the league, he was the wide receiver, 24. Your Honor, Mike Evans has never finished a season below 1,000 yards. He has the seventh most yards for a wide receiver in his first 6 years. He is a big play guy. Over the last 2 years, wide receivers with 100 or more receptions. Here are the guys with the highest yards per reception: Mike Williams, Kenny Golladay, and Mike Evans. That's right, Your Honor. Mike Evans has a higher yards per reception than deep threats like DeSean Jackson, Tyreek Hill, and Marvin Jones. Now I move the committee to see Tom Brady. Tom Brady, the plant man, a.k.a. the GOAT, a.k.a. the best quarterback of all time, is now in Tampa Bay. And you might say, well, he's lost it. But here's the thing. Tom Brady last year, even with his ragtag crew at the wide receiver position, he was still in the top half of the league in deep shots. He was league average in adjusted completion percentage. He had seven deep touchdowns compared to Jameis Winston's nine. So he was just trailing Jameis Winston, even with not going deep on every single play. Your Honor, Mike Evans is an elite stud at the wide receiver position, and I think it is egregious, heinous, terrible what my colleagues are doing to his ranking. I rest my case.
All right, Judge, we need a ruling. Otherwise, we'll just argue with each other further.
The fantasy court rules in favor of the defendant.
Yes. A beautiful man.
I don't like this judge at all. Is it possible to also sue the judge?
It is never. Not possible not to do possible. That. I'm pretty confident you can't do that.
All right. All right. We're moving on.
Plaintiffs Mike Wright and Andy Holloway are accusing Jason, the awesome one, of egregious misrepresentation and felonious baiting of Allen Robinson.
Your Honor.
You got to finish reading that crime.
Also known as the Target Monster.
Thank you. Your Honor, please note that the announcer was trying to leave out crucial evidence to my case. Allen Robinson last year finished as a top 12 wide receiver. That is a wide receiver one. That is a player you want on your fantasy roster. Your Honor, Allen Robinson finished third in targets. What we know about statistics for the wide receiver position, touchdowns are hard to predict. Yards, a little bit tougher to predict. Targets are sticky because targets
are forever.
Are forever. Targets are a skill statistic. Last year, we only had five wide receivers hit the 150 target mark. And Allen Robinson, as I said, he was a part of that. Who else will the unknown starting quarterback throw the ball to? Will it be Trubisky? Will it be Nick Foles? It does not matter because we are talking about the wide receiver who in 2015 put up 1,400 yards and 14 touchdowns with Blake the Snake Bortles. Your Honor, Allen Robinson is a fantastic player. He will be the number one target for Chicago. And he's going to
snake, man.
And he's going to be great for fantasy football.
Your Honor, to be clear, Jason has Allen Robinson as his 22nd ranked wide receiver. I want the court to understand.
That's barely a wide receiver.
The court to understand why we're bringing this case. This is not some small decline in his fantasy.
1,100 yards and seven touchdowns, Your Honor.
Okay. So is it my turn, Skeeter?
Yes, yes. Go ahead, defense.
All right, here's the thing about the target monster is that he's not always a target monster. He's a target monster when he needs to be a target monster, and that makes sense. He's a great wide receiver. He is. This is not an anti-Allen Robinson's talent take. He's fantastic. It's not an anti-Allen Robinson's athleticism. It's not even saying he's not the number one. He's the clear number one on the team. But what that means is different depending on who else is on the field. My case rests on the last six games of last season. You had a pace for Allen Robinson during that time of 181 targets. Do you want to know why? Because Taylor Gabriel was injured. Oh, wait. No, Anthony Miller was injured. No, wait. Trey Burton was injured. No, their whole receiving core was gone. And he had 181 target pace for a reason. It was because you throw it to him or nobody. Tariq Cohen was the number two target. He's a running back. 2 years ago, when he was also the number one for this same team, and those other guys were not injured, he had a 16-game pace of 116 targets. That does not get it done. Now, I don't have him projected for that. I've got him with 140 target pace as the clear leader. But Anthony Miller's great. He's a really, really good wide receiver. You know, they brought in Jimmy Graham, who I know. It's a joke. He's the corpse, and it's sad because the beat reporters are talking about how good he's been in camp. It's like, oh, that's not good. Because if Jimmy Graham's your standout, rut-row.
Well, we also have news. Matt Nagy refusing to name his starting tight end.
I don't doubt it. What a clever man. But he's going to have 60 targets. There's no way that Jimmy Graham doesn't come in and get paid all that money and get 60 targets. There's no way Anthony Miller disappears. And, uh-oh, if Nick Foles plays half the season, where does he love to throw the ball to? The outside, right? Where your sweetie D was? No. Maybe the judge can remind me. He likes going to the slot. Okay, that's fine. I mean, Anthony Miller will be good. My point is this. He is a good wide receiver. He is the number one wide receiver. But he's not a top 12 locked and loaded guy for the Bears' bad quarterback situation when there are other targets there to catch the ball. And if you look historically, I think you guys are having recency bias of the fact that he had a great fantasy season when he needed to, because he doesn't always have a great fantasy season. He's had two great fantasy seasons in 6 years. And I know he's been injured a couple times, but he's not locked and loaded as a wide receiver. One, he's a wide receiver. Two, I rest my case.
The fantasy court rules in favor of the plaintiff.
Ridiculous. I'm out of here.
Spectacular.
I will throw in, Jason, if you take out the final six games where you're saying that the target pace was just egregious,
mm-hmm.
he was still on pace for 138 targets.
I have him projected for 140.
That would be top 10 in targets. How is a guy top 10 in targets finishing at 22?
How many touchdowns do you think the Bears are throwing? A ton?
To Allen Robinson? At least seven.
Well, we will see. Look, I mean, this is I have failed to win the heart of the judge, but I knew he's a big Allen Robinson fan.
Yeah, I did too. It didn't matter what I said.
Completely pre-biased.
I'm going to be honest. Just, you know, I have no skin in the game. That's a lie. I think the judge went 0-3 today. Like, if I was, I thought I got a little bit convinced by Jason, but then I realized I have Allen Robinson at 12, and I'm just fine with that.
Yeah,
I'm right on the edge.
I've got him down for 140 targets. 1,100 yards and six touchdowns. I'm sure the touchdown is the difference, right? If I were to move him up to seven touchdowns,
he probably jumps 10 spots in your rankings.
Yeah, he jumps up quite a bit. It's just a matter of whether he gets that touchdown.
I want to get these three cases onto socials, and I want the Foot Clan to vote. I want to see if I'm right that the judge was 0-3 today.
Also, Judge, just remember who called you 0-3. I thought you were 3-3. You nailed it today.
No, he already changed the ruling.
Mike.
I know, but we go back to court at some point, fellas.
He's scoring points.
He's got
already.
All his memory like an elephant.
Oh, my goodness.
Best Ball Breakdown, presented by Underdog Fantasy.
Yeehaw! I love that drop, and I love Underdog, and I love playing best ball. So this is another tip for constructing a roster if you're playing, you know, Underdog, if you're playing best ball. And really, I think going back, you know, five episodes, maybe we should have done this one first, because I feel like this is the core of how I choose to build my team. It's about roster construction. We talk, you know, we've given lots of tips of, you know, certain players to target late, high upside, looking at variance, the 80-20 rule. But in general, the first step is knowing the outlook of how you want your team to look at the end of the draft. And you have to realize in that format, you start two running backs, you start three wide receivers, you only start one quarterback, one tight end, and the flex can be tight end. So taking all of our other tips into it, here's my tip today. You should have five quarterback / tight ends.
Hmm.
Five. That's my magic number. Two or three quarterbacks and two or three tight ends. One should help dictate the other. I don't want three quarterbacks and three tight ends. I don't want two quarterbacks and two tight ends. Now, usually this is somewhat dictated by which one of the big players at the onesie positions I grab. Did I end up grabbing Kyler Murray early in the draft? I'm only going two quarterbacks then. I'm going to take my shot at the breakout. Did I end up finding a value on Mark Andrews or Zach Ertz in those early rounds? Then I'm only going to go one tight end. That means one of those things should push.
Two tight ends total, right?
Yes, sorry. One other tight end, two tight ends total. Those decisions push the other position out of the way, allowing you to stack running backs and wide receivers. Usually at the end of the draft, I'm going to have one more wide receiver than I have running backs. So my tip is stick to five at the quarterback and the tight end position total, and have more wide receivers than you have running backs, because you start more the shotgun approach of just having something hit on a given week. I think that's the optimal roster construction for victory.
All right, make sure you sign up for Underdog Fantasy today and enter the Best Ball Mania for a chance at $1 million in prizes. Go to underdogfantasy.com or search for the Underdog Fantasy app in your app store. Mike,
let's
do some mailbag.
Mailbag.
Mailbag, yeah! I thought about jumping in with you there.
Hey, man. When,
after the intro.
All are welcome on the mailbag drop.
But all aren't good.
Oh, no.
Well, I didn't specify that part.
All right, if you have a question, head to the website, thefantasyfootballers.com. By the way, our week one rankings, the start-sit tool, all of those in-season tools are going to hit on Monday of next week. We will not have a show on Monday. Monday is Labor Day. We are going to take a breather with the family and prepare for the next 16, 17 weeks of football and beyond. So no show Monday. We'll be back on Tuesday.
We will, however, be doing a little bit of work remotely on Monday to put our week one start sit tools, mm-hmm. our week one rankings, all those things will be live next week. So if you're wondering when that's coming, wait for Monday afternoon and they'll be there.
Okay. It's good advice.
Thanks.
I just said all of that.
You talked about the rankings switchover?
I just said rankings on Monday and the start set tool on Monday.
No
I don't expect you to be listening to me
fair.
Speak, apparently. But that's okay.
Guilty as charged, Judge.
He looked so flabbergasted that I was laughing. But look, just in case you don't know, Monday the rankings are going up and the start set tool on the website.
Only thing I would add is that we're going to not do a show on Monday.
That's okay. Hey. Here's a question from Jake in Washington.
Oh, I love this question.
Who do you think will have more fantasy points before week seven? Chris Thompson or Antonio Gibson?
Antonio Gibson.
This would have been a really good question several hours ago.
It can't still be a good question? You don't think that Antonio Gibson will need an opportunity to establish himself in the offense?
No. No, Antonio Gibson established himself in training camp and will start week one as the starter. That's my...
You think he takes the first snap?
I think he takes the first snap.
Oh, man.
Snap.
That's a question I had for you, Mike.
I think he does, yeah.
Okay. Here's a voicemail question.
What's up, Mike, Andy, and Big Shimmy? I'm in a 12-man half PPR league, and I'm just curious, what is your favorite draft position to be in this year? Thanks, guys. Big fan of the show.
Hello. My favorite spot is still about nine in the draft.
Yeah, because you're all in on Jacobs.
Correct.
My favorite spot is still one, because I believe in the Christian McCaffrey edge.
I think after that last mock draft, I have kind of changed, even though my team was great, I've changed to like the running back 2-3 spot. I want an earlier shot at a running back in the second round while still maintaining one of those top three studs.
We did not announce this. Cam Newton's been named the starting quarterback.
Well, sort of.
Officially, right?
I believe we did announce that months ago. When it was...
And now the latest news was that it was announced in the team meeting, except now Bill Belichick is pulling a Matt Nagy.
Oh, is he saying, just kidding?
Well, he won't say publicly. Bill, look, I've spent all my rant energy on Matt Nagy. I don't have enough to go through it
at
again
least,
for Bill Belichick.
I'll give him this credit. The difference between preparing for Mitch Trubisky and Nick Foles is different than Jared Stidham and Cam Newton. I will give him that. They're a different quarterback altogether.
Yes, we will give him that.
But that's it. And it's still silly. What's his floor and ceiling in New England? To be fair, because this is not Cam Newton of 5 years ago.
Sure.
This is a new home, new offense, difficult to learn, still has the legs, but...
I hate my ranking of Cam Newton.
Because, I don't like it either.
No, I mean, he's in my early 20s, and when I look at it, the reason is because I've got his rushing yardage down a little bit, his rushing touchdown down a little bit from what he usually does as his baseline. When I think about Cam Newton and the fact that when he's on the field for fantasy as an elite athlete on the ground, he's always crushing that number. He's always a top 12 quarterback. So I think his range of outcomes is, you know, quarterback 5 to about where I've got him ranked at his floor, barring injury, and I don't like it. So I would say quarterback 5 to 20.
Yeah, I think his ceiling is he's booty scooting Cam Newton again, and he ends up in the top 5. But meanwhile, the floor... I think you're right, Jason, around the 20s or so. Thank you.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it was two really rough injury-plagued weeks the last time we saw him on the field. According to camp reports, there haven't been a lot of splash plays. He has very underwhelming weapons in the passing game right now.
So Cam Newton's entire career.
His whole career. Yeah, I have him at 13, Mike at 9 right now, Jason at 14. So
I think that
is totally reasonable, and he is a player that you can do two things. You can take him as you can give him the shot if you draft real late and you grab Cam Newton, or he's another player that, you know, if you went really late with a quarterback, I don't mind going to quarterback situation.
Sure.
Just to see what you have week one. Let's say you took give me another late round quarterback. Let's say you took Big Ben. Let's say you wanted to see if Big Ben still had it. You want to see if Cam still had it, and they're your last two picks.
I have had the Big Ben Cam stack in several mocks and real drafts. That is a legitimately real strategy.
Yep.
They go so late, and between those two, one's going to be great.
And he's still going late. We had our listener league draft 2 days ago. I believe I was the last
one to
take a quarterback, and I was able to get Cam Newton. The other guy I would throw out, I like the addition of Big Ben. It would be Ryan Tannehill. I think you can get him probably after waivers. See if last year was the truth or not.
All right, David Horn, kind of the opposite question that we got earlier. What is the draft spot you hate drafting from and why?
I hate drafting from the 7 or so because when I look at my rankings, the running backs, and actually I would even go earlier, 5, 6.
Really?
Well, because I've got Kenyon Drake as my running back 4 right now, which I know is against the grain. That's my probably most outlandish number.
We should have brought that up.
Why
didn't we bring that case?
Because he could be the running back 4. I fully believe that can happen.
And so when I'm there, I'm going to take Drake, but I don't need to. You know what I mean? Like I can get Drake at the 10-11 spot, so I hate when I feel like I'm just, you know, lighting value on fire.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say that if I'm at 11, 12, you know, the 11th pick or the 12th pick, and Jacobs and Mixon are gone, I haven't liked the way the rest of the draft pans out.
Yeah, I did not like picking at the edge of a 14-teamer because
was rough on both of you.
The whole first round was a running back run, as it should be, because that's why we'll be taking in that spot. And by the time you get to the 13th, 14th pick, now you're down to here I could take a tier 3 running back, or I could take Davante Adams, who could be the number 1 wide receiver,
and Julio Jones.
Yeah.
He went back to back and got two of the best players in fantasy because sometimes you got to zig when everybody's zagging.
All right, Boyd Topher says, who's the better streaming option, floating down P River or taking a stroll through the Mayfield?
Except not week one. That is the problem. I wanted to draft Mayfield in our listener league draft because I have Odell Beckham, and I actually believe in Baker this year as a really good bounce back post hype candidate. But week one is on the road against the Ravens, so I don't feel like I can draft him in that streaming category.
I believe, are the Colts playing the Jaguars?
Yes.
Yeah, so I would be playing Philip Rivers.
Yeah, I would as well.
I really don't believe in Baker Mayfield.
That's fair. That's totally fair.
I really don't.
He looked horrific watching him last year.
Yeah, I'm preparing my bold predictions article, and there's some Baker Mayfield disdain found within that article.
Last year, I'm sorry. No, last year he should be sorry for last year, and I'm sure he is.
All right. We're going to close it down. I hope everybody has an incredible weekend. If you're drafting, check out the Ultimate Draft Kit right now.
Still getting updated.
Yeah, yeah. Antonio Gibson is the new number one overall running back, quarterback, wide receiver, and tight end.
You're saying that like it's a joke, but it's happening.
We are holding Mike back. The Ultimate Draft Kit is up to date, though, this morning and each and every day. Rankings, tweaks, and changes.
Look who's on there.
Hey, Baker.
It's Baker on
the Ultimate sometimes Draft dominating Kit. Your 2020 draft is to listen to last year's Ultimate Draft Kit, where Baker was actually in the bust category.
That is true.
Despite the hope for him, he was being overdrafted. It's not about talent. It's sometimes about just the ADP and the draft price, players being overdrafted. And we had him in there. You can check that out at ultimatedraftkit.com. You can get in the Mega Bowl at jointhefoot.com. And thanks for nothing, Judge. I'm kidding.
No problem.
I appreciate you taking the time out of your busy court schedule and
working your beard in. Looks wonderful today, Brooks.
Yeah.
See you on Monday or Tuesday. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter at the FFBallers.
And Foot Clan, don't forget about Simply Safe. They've got everything you need to protect your home with none of the drawbacks of traditional home security. Set it up yourself under an hour. No contract, no pushy sales guys, no hidden fees or fine print. All for starting at $15 a month. Try Simply Safe today at simplysafe.com/footballers. You get free shipping and a 60-day risk-free trial. There's nothing to lose.